famous for his mistresses.
He had a couple of wives.
For his shoes.
He loved fashion.
And for building the Palace of Versailles.
He was the king of France.
And for being Europe's longest serving monarch.
He was genius. He was a rock and roll star.
And from his iconic appearance as the rising sun in Le Ballet de la Nuit, or the Ballet of the Night of 1653, Louis XIV would become synonymous with the art of ballet. He was the king who danced, defining and popularizing an art form that was the very essence of nobility, uniting politics and dance like never before, and placing ballet firmly at the heart of civilized culture. Louis was the flame that would ignite a revolution in dance, that would give birth to the ballet that we know today. I've always been fascinated by Louis XIV of France since I first read about him as a young boy starting to learn ballet myself. Even at that young age, I was aware of the prejudice against boys learning to dance, and it seemed to me extraordinary that here was a king of roughly my own age who danced, who did ballet, like me. And even 300 years after his death, Louis still remains for me ballet's first great icon. Under his reign, classical ballet took its first steps towards becoming an art form in its own right, not just in France, but across the whole of Europe. Now I want to truly uncover Louis's contribution as I make him the subject of a brand new dance piece for the Birmingham Royal Ballet. The King Dances is inspired by the Ballet de la Nuit, a landmark performance that reputedly lasted all night and featured at its climax a 14-year-old Louis dancing the role of the rising sun. Louis XIV was born on the 5th of September, 1638. His parents, Louis XIII and Anne of Austria, had taken 22 years to produce an heir, and Louis' birth was hailed as a miracle. He was Dieu donné, literally God given. In 1643, Louis' father, who had also been a keen dancer, died, making Louis the King of France at the tender age of 4. In the France that Louis inherited, dance was a crucial part of the social hierarchy. A gentleman needed to have 3 skills: horse riding, fencing, and dancing. And as the future king, Louis would have been expected to learn to dance almost as soon as he could walk. Ballet dancers today train for years to become the living embodiment of an ideal of noble behavior that harks back to an era when everything was done with effortless refinement and regal grace. Only now, this only takes place within the confines of a dance studio or on stage for a paying public. But in Louis' day, although there were public entertainments, like the Commedia dell'arte, ballet was reserved for the upper class, for the nobility, and it only took place at the royal courts. Originating in 15th century Italy, where they were called balletti, these dances were adopted by the French, who called them ballet de cour, court ballets, and were danced by royalty, nobility, and foreign dignitaries, who aimed to entrance their peers in the audience.
The ballet de cour, well, they were big cool spectacles that involved singing, recitations, different kind of dancing, pantomime, and they were very different from the type of ballet that we have today. They weren't really constructed around a narrative, but more like a loose theme, like the seasons or the arts or the music.
And were they just entertainment? What purpose did they serve?
If you go right back to the 16th century, they had this kind of magical belief that by performing dance, you could bring down celestial influence. And it was all about trying to recreate harmony on Earth. And then it really becomes a kind of early modern form of propaganda. You know, in the days they didn't have television, that was one way of representing with a twist the latest events. The idea was that they were, you know, trying to promote the glory of France, the grandeur of the monarch. So they were kind of PR exercises, really.
One man who certainly saw the value of using these early ballets as propaganda was Cardinal Mazarin, who, together with Louis's mother, Anne of Austria, ruled over France whilst Louis was still a child.
Cardinal Mazarin in the 16th century has been the most powerful politician in France. He's of modest extraction. He was born in Italy, and after the death of Louis XIII, he became prime minister in France.
And how did Mazarin influence Louis?
Mazarin is precisely responsible for the education of Louis, and in several fields, in the artistic fields, and especially in the political fields.
He was his godfather, wasn't he? That's what I understood.
Yeah, and a governor for the young king. The taste of the king for Italian paintings, for architecture, for political representation and the dance is coming entirely from Mazarin.
A ballet class today typically starts at the bar and then progresses to the center of the studio, where the dancers run through a drill of exercises all based around the five basic ballet positions, from first to fifth. From what I've read, Louis XIV is supposed to have done a ballet class every day for 20 years, taught by the dancing master Pierre Beauchamp. But what kind of class would he have done?
The first lesson is to turn out. And from the hips for a good balance. Because it's easier to go like that and then like that. Then, comme ça. That is very difficult.
And I suppose later as well, that turnout from the top of the leg allowed dancers to lift legs higher.
Exactly, because it's very functional. Yeah, it's like that, you can't do more than Nicolas, ça va très, très, très haut.
The dancing masters of Louis's time were both dancers and musicians. They would play small violins called pochettes as they drilled the great and the good in the dance technique they needed to know for both social dancing and for the ballet de cour.
They learn all the positions, one and two and three and four and five, and how to go, how to...
Move from one to the other.
Yes.
Were the five positions of the feet paralleled by five positions of the arms as they are in modern ballet?
No, not at all, no. The basic rule is that when you have feet like that in first position or second position, you have to elevate and that is finished. So you have always to do that.
So the wrist, it is in the wrist rather than the
yes,
the arm position. The wrist is elevated
exactly,
or down.
Yeah.
One, two, and one.
To kickstart my choreography for the King Dancers, I've asked Baroque dance expert and teacher Edith Lalanger to give a workshop for myself and some of my dancers. It proved surprisingly challenging. The Baroque dance was the kind of precursor of modern-day ballet, and we have an awful lot in common in terms of steps and heads and general movements. But when I tried to dance this work, when she did a small demonstration and some of my dancers and I tried to do this work, we realized what a different vocabulary it is. and how different the coordination between feet, legs, and arms has become.
Pas de bourrée, un pas de bourrée.
I'm not after making something which is absolutely, you know, true to the Baroque. I can't learn how to master essentially a different dance technique. My dancers, they can't retrain and become Baroque dance specialists. But to get the atmosphere, to get some of the rules, to get some of the tricks, and some of the reasoning behind why they moved like this. I very rarely seem to see a fifth position.
It's true. What is parallel is not beautiful.
It's not beautiful.
No.
But it's great to know things and understand things like that. Why the arms were slightly lowered, why they were in front, because these people, they wore beautiful costumes, because they had beautiful lace half of the time on their sleeves, and it was a way of showing the costume off. I wanted to try these steps out myself. I wanted to have a go at them to know how they feel. They don't look difficult. They are very difficult. They employ a completely different set of muscles to that of modern classical ballet. And my old knees, they really started hurting after a while. I was great. There is a theory that dance and the ballet de cour were used by the French kings to keep the nobility busy and out of mischief. However, when Louis was 10 years old, a rebellion broke out against higher taxation, which quickly snowballed into a civil war called the Fronde, which ended up pitting some of the most prominent members of the nobility against Louis's mother Anne and First Minister Cardinal Mazarin. The Fronde, named after the slings used to target the windows of France's most hated man, Cardinal Mazarin, was to last for almost 5 years. Why was Mazarin so disliked by the French people?
The main reproaches made against Mazarin during the Fronde were linked to his foreign extraction. Mazarin was of Italian origin and was the most wealthy man in France. So Mazarin was disliked because of his wealth and because of the exclusive influence he had on the young king.
When Louis was 12 years old, a mob of Frondeurs broke into the Palais Royal over there, demanding to see the boy king. They were tired of the rule of Cardinal Mazarin and wanted to make personal representations to the king himself. Now, legend has it that his mother Anne told Louis to pretend to be asleep. And when the Frondeurs finally got into the royal bedchamber, they were so entranced by the vulnerable beauty of the king that they quietly left. It must have been a terrifying experience for Louis. In 1653, after almost 5 years of fighting, the Fronde were finally defeated with the aid of some of the British nobility, including the future King of England, James II. With the rebellion quelled, there was only one thing left to do: put on a ballet, the Ballet de la Nuit. This is Wadsden Manor in Aylesbury, which was built in 1883 by the Francophile Baron Ferdinand Rothschild. It houses a unique volume from 1653 containing 129 designs for the Ballet de la Nuit, a grand spectacle that was intended to thrust Louis into the limelight and ensure the Frondeurs remained defeated.
Well, it was a court ballet, Ballet de Cour. It had six performances at the Palace Theatre of the Petit Bourbon in Paris. It was put on for the entertainment of the court, but it also had Louis XIV himself dancing in it with some of his courtiers. And it was divided into four watches of the night, and it covered the 12 hours between sunset and sunrise.
I mean, I've heard that it ran in real time for 12 hours.
I think it did, because the best eyewitness we've got, and he went to two performances, and that was Jean Loret, who was a journalist, and he goes to the first night, where he has to queue for 3 hours just to get into the theatre. When he gets in there, he's been assigned a lousy seat. He says, I'm far away from the action, I'm right up high, I can't see a thing, and I was stuck there for 13 hours. So I think it probably was pretty well in real time.
Did the Ballet de la Nuit have a story? What was it about?
It didn't have a narrative that went right through the ballet. What it had was a theme, and the theme of this was the passing of the night, the inevitability of day following night, if you want to put that into ethical terms, of good chasing out evil, and if you want to apply it politically to Louis XIV, which is what they were doing, this new king, aged 14, bringing hope after or towards the end of civil war in France and reasserting the authority of the crown.
The illustrations in the book at Wadsden Manor are magnificent, featuring fantasy characters like werewolves, witches, anthropomorphic representations of playing games, and an owl-headed Satan. But one image which is missing from this volume is Louis as the rising sun, which only exists as a separate illustration locked away in Paris. What's also missing is any indication of what the actual dancing was like, because there was no way of writing down or notating theatrical dance steps at this time. Although we have no documentation to show us what Louis did as the rising sun, there is notation for a male solo from later in the 17th century, which depicts the entrance of Apollo, the sun god. And it's possibly the nearest we'll get to knowing how the 14-year-old Louis would have danced.
All the steps in this solo correspond exactly to the normal vocabulary for what we call high dancing or noble dancing. It's also very interesting because it's very square choreography, not too much turning, not too many ornaments. It would fit for a very young man.
Extravagant costumes, including masks, were an important part of the Ballet de Cour, and together with innovative scenery, they helped transport 17th century audiences to fantastical worlds, inspired by both classical mythology and contemporary events. Design still plays a key role in theatre today, and in The King Dances, I've enlisted a team of designers to help create the visual world for my choreography. It can be quite a process of negotiation to find the best solutions within a tight budget. And then they
just stand facing. I'm working with people for whom this kind of restriction and this kind of cap tends to be a spur for greater creativity. You know, when necessity is the mother of invention. If you can't make it work for you haven't got £1,000, then you make something which looks as good for £50, and that keeps our masters happy.
I do want him to be able to reflect and glimmer, but I think it should be gold.
I don't think that money was any object when it came to staging Louis's ballets. Unfortunately, I am not the king, and you have to be a little bit more realistic.
Since 1653, no one has heard what the Ballet de la Nuit would have sounded like in its entirety. But at the MC2 complex in Grenoble, an extraordinary recording is taking place. From the bare bones of the existing musical archive, Sébastien Dorsay has spent 3 years recreating the orchestral score for the Ballet de la Nuit.
At the beginning, when I saw the score, I told myself, oh, 78 dances all in G minor. Wow. And we have more than 1 hour only with dances. And these dances are very, very strange to us today because they are not minuet, gavotte, and all these normal Baroque dances, very regular dances. It's a sort of fantasy, sometimes very regular, sometimes very strange with interruptions.
Very theatrical, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, and we can imagine it was for all this night. We had to impress people, we had to convince, to seduce, to frighten. Each dance is very, very specific.
The music for the Ballet de la Nuit is often credited to Jean-Baptiste Lully, the Italian-born composer who would rise to prominence under Louis XIV, becoming the director of the Académie Royale de Musique, which would later become the Paris Opera Ballet.
We hear that Lully was the composer of this piece. Is that true?
We don't know exactly who composed the dances. Maybe Louis Constantin, very probably, but probably other people. We don't know exactly. Probably Lully for 1, 2, 3 dances, we don't know exactly.
Why do you think that this piece of music is so significant?
We know Lully opera as the beginning of the French Baroque, but all this time before has been totally unexplored. A lot of this ballet music is totally unknown today. So it's a special experience for us, and especially with this one, which have been the most important at this time. Everything was planned to be a most wonderful performance and probably the best way to put in mind to all these people that the king is Louis XIV. Not only your king, but the king of the universe.
I can't think of a more extraordinary way to celebrate the end of a civil war. The Ballet de la Nuit was a major event, and the image of Louis as Le Roi Soleil, the Sun King, must have been burnt into the imagination of everybody that saw it.
The eyewitness accounts say that it was phenomenal to see it. Well, Louis XIV himself was a very, very good dancer. There's so many accounts of that, I think it must have been true. So what better way, what way to convince people by putting on a ballet which showcased the king as a dancer, getting across these messages that the hope of France was a strong monarchy under Louis XIV. Louis seems to have been driven by this sense of destiny, that he was there to look after France, to do what was best for France, and it could be the seeds of that were being sown here.
As a PR stunt, the Ballet de la Nuit was extremely effective. The nobles bowed to the teenage Louis's authority, and confidence in France was restored. Yet extremes of wealth and poverty still plagued the country, where the noble classes made up less than 1% of the population, but ruled over the millions of peasants and commoners. This is a dance solo for a peasant from 1697. It's an example of what is called a grotesque role, which were often danced by noblemen or even the king himself.
Was this the nobility mocking the peasant class? Did they find them funny?
I think it was sometimes very ironical. The feeling of the separation between the classes was very different from ours. They were not separated in common life, but the way to do the thing is always to show they were well-educated, and so we can see the gap between the other and us.
Superior.
Yeah. Yes, but also to feel how far we are from them, and so they can make caricature.
Even back in Louis' time, dancing was more than just doing the steps. It was about conveying character, feeling, and emotion.
It's the choreography that shows your emotions. If I want to express, I will do the gest. If I am sad, I will do to let emotions come from the choreography. That's the point.
And I suppose, again, the fact that they were masked means
yes.
that the meaning must come through the
exactly.
body and
yes.
through the choreography.
Exactly.
We can't act.
Exactly, exactly.
Louis didn't actually take the reins of power until he was 22, when his mentor, Cardinal Mazarin, died.
Mazarin died the 9th of March 1661, and this date is the beginning of the absolutism in France, because the day after, the king gathered all the council and said that from now he will rule alone over the country.
No more prime ministers?
No more prime minister, and Mazarin has been the last prime minister in France up to the French Revolution.
Cardinal Mazarin, who wielded the power in France whilst Louis was a child, and who in all likelihood commissioned the Ballet de la Nuit, is actually the starting point for my new ballet, The King Dances. The composer Stephen Montagu has provided a piano score of the music for the opening of my piece, and I have the idea to begin the ballet with a solo for a character who represents both la nuit, the night, and Cardinal Mazarin.
I'm Ian Mackay, and I play Cardinal Mazarin in The King Dances. My first take on Mazarin is that he's sinister and he's very manipulative in the background, but always trying to take control.
Oops. Well, that finished.
If you watch David in the studio when he's trying to work out how he wants the move to be, for me that's a telltale sign as to what your character is and how you want it to be, you know, if you keep your eye on David.
Yes, let's do that instead. Tia, pa, coupe, and...
Mm-hmm. I'm about a third of the way through this particular section, and I've given myself a couple of days to do it, so... It should be fine. On course. Some things are working better than others. And I want to bring out something a bit more in the arms. It's not quite decorative enough, and that's one of the features of Baroque dance, is the arms are very decorative. So I've got to bring out a little bit more of that. But yeah. Day one, it's fine.
One of the things which has always intrigued and fascinated me about dance during Louis' time was that it was dominated by men. But in 1654, just a year after the Ballet de la Nuit, a new ballet featured a groundbreaking moment. Louis dancing together with women. Yes, boy.
The first ballets under Louis XIV were still performed by all male cast. This is probably due to reasons of propriety, but also technical considerations. For instance, the need to wear full-length costumes. If you wear a floor-length dress, there's no way you can perform really elaborate choreographies. Women were not supposed to jump or any other undignified movements that could even make their ankles appear or something similarly scandalous. And one important event was the Ballet des Noces de Pélée et de Tétis, which was performed in 1654. And in the opening scene, you famously have Louis appearing as Apollo in the midst of nine beautiful women, as the muses. The novelty of the scene underlines the new image that is created of Louis XIV now as a king in full command of his kingdom. He is free to think of pleasures, but also of ensuring his dynasty. So it makes sense to cast real women in that scene.
Up until this point, female roles in the Ballet de Cour were danced by men wearing masks, wigs and female costumes, just as some of my male dancers will be doing in The King Dances. We can only speculate who decided that real women should dance with the 15-year-old Louis. Perhaps it was Cardinal Mazarin, who saw the PR value of making Louis a sex symbol. But once Louis had set this precedent, more and more noble women began to dance together with their male counterparts in the Ballet de Cour. Female dancers had been liberated, not only for social dancers, but as performers. And this was a trend that would spread outwards from France across the whole of Europe.
How did men and women dance together at that time? Did they partner each other? Was there contact?
Oh. So few contact, just the hand. It may be the look. Always, you know, as if they were in the sky.
Celestial bodies, yes, planets.
Yes, exactly. And so there is an attraction between the both of them.
This duet is from Jean-Baptiste Lully's 1682 opera, Per Se. It may have been danced by one couple or a group of couples. No one knows for sure, but it's very different from the full contact pas de deux of classical ballets today.
I had intended, as in the Ballet de la Nuit, to have an all-male cast for the King Dances. But my composer, Stephen Montague, wrote me a duet which was so ethereal and delicate that I knew that I couldn't have a man dancing the role of Selene, the goddess of the moon. Louis's relationships with women, his mother, his wives, his mistresses, were very profound. He never allowed them to interfere with politics or government, but they certainly had a big impact on his outlook on life. And I think that Selene represents all of these women. With Mazarin gone, Louis would go on to shore up his power base by personally dominating the nobility, taking over the army, and establishing a monarchy of absolute rule, where only his word was the law. But before all that, he wanted to found the world's first Royal Academy of Dance.
The Académie Royale de Danse, believed to be founded in a room in the Louvre, was formed of 13 dancing masters who would oversee the teaching of both dance and the physical etiquette of daily life.
This wasn't just about teaching dance steps. This was about teaching nobility, teaching grace.
Grace comes from an antique ideal. If you don't know grace, you cannot be noble, at least in appearance. One of the main principles of grace is the opposition of the parts of the body. So the head is going in one way, the torso in another way, the legs in a separate way, and the arms also in accordance to the feet position. Nobility is superiority, so it must show in the body that was the specialty of the dancing master. He was the one who can teach you how to be noble.
Monsieur, soignez votre tour de jambe.
It was very important for any nobleman to know how to bow, to know how to walk with distinction, to know how to carry the body, and also to have this peculiar body of the nobility at the time, with the shoulder very backwards and a very straightened body, and also this turnout of the feet, even in the common life.
Monsieur, le premier couplet de la vocale.
By offering both rules and training on how to comport yourself for social success, as well as increasingly structured dance technique, French dancing masters provided an attractive package for both nobility and anyone who aspired to climb up the ranks of civilized society. Soon, France's reputation for being at the heart of art and culture eclipsed even the Italians. French dance became known as La Belle Dance, or the beautiful dance, and it became more and more fashionable. French dancing masters became an exportable commodity, spreading the gospel of French ballet right across Europe.
What everybody wanted was to be taught by a French dancing master, to be taught French dancing, to see French dancers on the stage. In the 1690s, Antony Labbé came over from the Paris Opera, and he never went back. He stayed for 40 years, choreographing for the London stage, dancing at court for William III, and ultimately teaching the grandchildren of George I. So he made a huge career out of this. Other French dancing masters came and settled, and some of them weren't even French, they just said they were French.
In 1670, after 75 roles in 26 performances, Louis XIV decided to give up dancing in the Ballet de Cour.
Even though he'd stopped dancing, Louis' patronage of the ballet continued. And in 1674, he asked the dancing master and choreographer Pierre Beauchamp, who he had danced with in the Ballet de la Nuit, to codify the five basic positions of ballet.
By this time, ballet, its positions and inherent sense of grace, were such an integral part of aristocratic life that the five ballet positions weren't only important for dance, they were also used in art. This famous painting of Louis was made in 1701 by the artist Hyacinthe Rigaud and shows Louis in an exemplary fourth position.
It's a position of nobility, of majesty, a way to show grace, but also superiority. Other positions like the first or the third position, which are where the feet are closed like this, are more associated to modest connotations. Here you have grace, but you have also majesty, which was important.
This painting, which actually featured Louis' face transposed onto the image of a body double, was reproduced countless times and became a hugely influential work of royal art, establishing a style of portraiture that was copied across the civilized world. Fourth position became the de facto stance for the wealthy and powerful.
It wasn't until 1700 that Raoul Foyer published a work that perfected the notation system begun by Beauchamp. This was a giant leap forward for dance. Now ballets could be written down with the use of symbols. They could be printed, published, and disseminated. French dance, La Belle Danse, could be preserved and recreated forever.
Nowadays, we can even use our phones to record rehearsals and movements, but there's still a place for notation. Most new ballets, like the King Dancers, are still written down in dance notation. It's not the same one that Beauchamp and Feuillet developed, but a form called Benish, which was created much later. But it still uses the same technique of having symbols for individual movements of the body and floor patterns to create a diagrammatic plan of the dance, a bit like a musical score that can be preserved and shared, just as perhaps Louis had planned when he commissioned notation to be developed. The peak of Louis's reign came in 1679, when Paris gave him the title of Louis le Grand. He'd put his stamp on the country in terms of industries, academies, arts, politics, even the borders of France itself. And in 1682, in an audacious attempt to secure his grip on the nobility, he moved the royal court, the seat of government, from Paris to Versailles. Louis's use of grand spectacles to promote an image of France as a wealthy and powerful country reached its apogee in Versailles, where feasts, masked balls, operas, plays, fireworks, and the occasional ballet would almost entirely consume the time and energies of Louis's court. However, these entertainments didn't come cheap. How much money did Louis spend on these ballets and spectacles, and did the French people ever resent him because of that?
Well, I think he probably spent a huge amount. If you look at one of these big Versailles festivals, like the one that took place in July 1668, we know that £150,000 were spent on just this one day. A ballet on its own would have been less expensive. And we know that the ballet d'Hercule Amoureux, danced in 1662, cost just under £89,000. If you compare that with the average salary in those days, a daily labourer would get about £1.50 a week, possibly going up to £3, but that's about it. In terms of knowing what the French public thought is difficult, because you know, the poor don't leave any records.
He was very careful to have descriptions of the spectacles he organized or performed and published, you know, so people would hear of them also in foreign countries. Yeah, it was a means of propaganda, obviously. Later, when he organized all his spectacles in Versailles, he said it has to be really extraordinary, and that's a way to hold our subjects' hearts and spirits more firmly than by acts of beneficence, you know, to organize these grand spectacles. For the foreigners, all these expenses that might seem superfluous always create an impression, a very advantageous impression of magnificence, power, wealth, and greatness.
In addition to the spectacles at Versailles, an increasing number of ballets were being performed on public stages, where it was deemed unseemly for noble women to appear. So professional female dancers were needed to fill these roles.
In the ceiling, here at the Foyer de la Danse in the Paris Opera, you can see the queens of ballet. And the first of these was Mademoiselle de la Fontaine, who danced in Jean-Baptiste Lully's ballet, Le Triomphe de l'Amour, in 1681.
So, Julia, what do we know about Mademoiselle de la Fontaine?
Not very much. We don't even know her first name. She was born around 1655 and first appeared in the opera in the Triomphe de l'Amour, which was the first ballet in which female dancers were allowed on the opera stage. And she was tall and well-proportioned and soon became an example of the noble style. And she was the first soloist in the Paris opera. And she was even allowed to compose her own entries, which was a unique honor for a woman.
Other women quickly followed La Fontaine's example. This solo, danced by Irène Fest, was originally performed by Marie-Thérèse Soubligny.
She was the first professional female dancer to appear in England. That was seen as quite an interesting novelty, apparently, because one critic called her a surprising monster, but other critics were delighted. She inspired women to become dancers in England. And in 1703, a young lady called the Devonshire Girl did an imitation of Mademoiselle de Subligny in London.
The third female professional dancer to make an impact during Louis's reign was Françoise Prévot.
She was significant for three reasons. She had a very long, distinguished career as a dancer. She was the leading French ballerina for almost three decades. And she used the expressive powers of dance in her own creation. And she was the teacher of the two first real star ballerinas who challenged male predominance in ballet, Marie-Anne Cupy de Camargo and Marie Salé.
How significant were these three queens of ballet in the development of ballet as we know it?
Well, they were pioneers and they were the first female creators at the opera. They're the very first professional female dancers. And of course, dancing style has have evolved a lot since then. But I mean, it was then that the foundation of present-day ballet was laid.
Towards the end of his life, living along with his court here in the glorious opulence of the Palace of Versailles, Louis was plagued by further wars, internal conflict, ill health, and the death of his first wife and immediate heirs. He became increasingly distant from the theatre, and under the influence of his second wife, Madame de Maintenon, he was more likely to be seen in a church than at a court ballet. But by this time, the development of ballet had gained its own momentum, and the art would continue to shift and to evolve.
The ballet de cour is supposed to have died when Louis stopped dancing, but dance didn't sort of stop overnight at the court of Louis. There were still balls, masked balls, masquerades, dance interludes in plays, etc. Later on, in the 1690s, a new form emerged, which was known as opera ballet. And this was a kind of cross between court ballet and opera. It started with a prologue, and then you had a series of self-contained acts, each one revolving around a separate theme.
Although there's no story in The King Dances, there is a thematic exploration of Louis's journey to kingship spread across four sections, just like in the Ballet de la Nuit, albeit lasting just 35 minutes rather than 12 hours.
It alternates between being something very formal and baroque and something very contemporary. So it's moving between those two worlds and finding a language which will allow me to do that. I never start seriously thinking about a ballet without having a very, very strong idea of who the leading roles will be played by. You know, there's no point in creating a role in your head, doing all that work, getting into the studio and finding that you haven't got a dancer that can do it. It's as much to do with their creativity as it is with mine. You know, they create the roles.
It's been interesting kind of trying to find a character for Louis and trying to put myself in his situation, which is one of, you know, he's a massively powerful, but he was so powerful from so young. How much confidence would he actually have had, and how much guidance would he have had, and How scared would he have been?
At the turn of the century, a combination of international and domestic pressures began to humble the power of the Sun King. Former allies like England had turned against Louis. France was losing wars, and the country was increasingly bankrupt.
In 1713, at the ripe old age of 75, Louis must have known that he didn't have much longer to live. Faced with his own mortality and with France in decline, he still had the power to enforce one more act that would cement his name in ballet's history books.
This is the Paris Opera Ballet School, where the 161 students still bow and curtsy to every adult they come across, just as Louis' courtiers would have done in the 17th century. It's a tradition which goes hand in hand with the rest of the school, where Baroque dance classes are still taught and every child receives a free education, thanks to Louis' decree in 1713 that there should be free training for the dancers of the Paris Opera, thus establishing the world's first school of ballet.
He had the feeling that just before he died, that he had to keep the level of the dancer of the court. And the first name of this school was Conservatoire, to keep. That is very important, Conservatoire. And the transmission, like it's still here, it's only from one person to the other one, from the master to the student. And Louis XIV tried to codify it, so the words are completely in French. We are at the beginning of ballet, but after we receive from everywhere, from the Russian, from the Italian, but we still keep that purity. We use the same famous fourth position, fifth position. You have the nice shoulders, you have nice hips, and nice face, and that is coming from Louis XIV.
Louis died 300 years ago on the 1st of September, 1715, in this room in Versailles. After 72 years on the throne, he left France on the brink of bankruptcy, but a hugely important superpower, both politically and culturally. Shine on,
rising sun, shine on. I think he did indeed have a political agenda. He did indeed have an idea of France to be the greatest, and France was the greatest at that period, definitely. Not only because of the arts, but also militarily, because of all the wars. The bad thing was economically. I think really he ruined France, and he did a lot of harm to the poorest of the French. There was, of course, famine, and at the end of his reign was extremely hard for the French people. All the wars that he launched, that the debt had been multiplied by 10. Taxes went up a lot in France, and that created a lot of despair, and was probably, now historians say, what prompted the French Revolution.
And politically, what sort of systems remain in France as a result of Louis?
Well, obviously, he was an absolute monarch, and we are here under a republic today and a democracy. But what has remained is this idea that we want a father-like figure to lead the country, a strong figure. And maybe this is a legacy of Louis XIV.
There are just so many things that we don't know about Louis and his relationship to dance. And there's no empirical evidence to explode the multitude of myths that surround the Sun King. But what is true is that through his own personal devotion to dance, Louis placed ballet right at the heart of the most powerful and influential court in Europe.
I think he used ballet as a means of seduction, not only for his female partners or the female audience, but also for his people and the foreigners who witnessed that performance and saw his extraordinary performance dressed up all in golden rays. He was the sun shedding light on his surroundings, basically.
At the time of Louis XIV, there was an evolution. He ordered a notation. When you have to invent a notation, you have to think about exactly your practice and you have to make real choices in what is important in movement.
Louis XIV, he helped so much dance to develop, to keep it and to develop it. Also, the women begin to dance, and after that, they will be stars.
He founded the Académie de Musique and he founded the Académie de Danse. So he was the king, dancing king, and he loved dance, but also he created the job of dancer.
The King Dancers is finally finished, and I hope that I've infused it with what I've discovered about Louis. His relationship with Cardinal Mazarin, his role in the history of dance, and also how the Ballet de la Nuit was such a turning point for France, with the way it presented Louis as the savior of the country.
Louis XIV may or may not have been the king who invented ballet. I suppose no one can take the credit for single-handedly creating an entire art form. But he remains, for me, the world's first ballet icon, the king who loved to dance. And the image of Louis as a 14-year-old boy dressed as the sun burns as brightly now as it did in the Ballet de la Nuit over 350 years ago. It's taken over 2 years for all the elements of the King Dancers to come together. The music, the choreography, the design, and the lighting. But for me, the piece is the culmination of a lifelong fascination that I've had with Louis XIV. The King Dancers isn't an attempt at historic recreation. Rather, it's a particularly modern look at the Ballet de la Nuit and the journey that ballet, and in particular, male dancing, has taken since 1653, when quite literally, men were the kings of dance.
Thank you. Thank you. Still to come here on BBC4 this evening, we're heading into the desert with Planet Earth in just a moment.